my pleasure today to introduce two new friends. We're going to start the program with Sam Snow. He is the Spokane Lilac Festival president this year. And then Colonel Dykus will take over after Sam does a quick presentation. Sam is the, like I said, the 2023 Lilac Festival Association president. He was born and raised in Spokane and earned a double major in accounting and finance from Washington State University.
Go Cougs!
Thank you. Okay, I was waiting for it. Let's see. Following college, Sam obtained a CPA while doing corporate accounting work for Intel. Sam and his wife, Christy, raised their two children in the Portland, Oregon area until moving back to Spokane in 2016. He is currently working as an accounting manager at Itron in Liberty Lake, responsible for SEC reporting. And then after Sam, we will have Colonel Chesley Dykus. He is the commander of the 92nd Air Refueling Wing at Fairchild Air Force Base. The wing provides global reach air power and deploys expeditionary forces in support of worldwide combat, contingency, and humanitarian requirements. The wing operates 71 KC-135 Stratotanker aircraft, performing refueling, airlift, and aeromedical evacuation missions, supporting U.S. and coalition contingency operations and USS Stratacom strategic deterrence missions. Whew, that's a lot. As installation commander, Colonel Dykus is also responsible for activities and assigned functions of Fairchild Air Force Base and support for 18 associate units. He received his commission from the United States Air Force Academy in May 2000. He is a mobility pilot with worldwide operational experience, including service in support of Operation Southern Watch, Enduring Freedom, and Iraqi Freedom. His assignments include multiple positions in operational units, squadron command, and staff officer duties at headquarters, Air Mobility Command, and the White House. And prior to his current assignment, Colonel Dykus served as the Vice Commander of the 22nd Air Refueling Wing at McConnell Air Force Base in Kansas, and one of the Air Force's three core tanker wings. Colonel Dykus is a command pilot, having logged more than 3,800 hours in the KC-135, KC-46, C-17, and C-5 aircraft. Some of his education. His education is very impressive, but I told him I was going to highlight a few things. He obtained his Bachelor of Science in Environmental Engineering at the Air Force Academy in Colorado. He has a Master of Arts in Business Administration from Webster University in St. Louis, Missouri, and he has a Master of Science in Strategic Intelligence from the National Intelligence University in Washington, D.C. It has been my pleasure to get to know Colonel Dykus as his honorary commander this year, and I'm really glad to have both Sam and Colonel Dykus here. Sam, you'll get us started.
Hi everybody, thank you very much for having me. I'm looking forward to chatting a little bit about the Lilac Festival, which is more than just a parade, but I'll talk about that very briefly, and then we'll get to Colonel, because I know that's what most people really want to hear about, including myself. So I'm going to start off with a quick little video just to kind of introduce the Lilac Festival. This was made pre-COVID, so there may be a couple of data points in there that sound a little funny, but it's kind of a fun way to kick things off. So I'll start there, and then I'll chat a little bit about it.
It's hard every year, but I think the judges seem to deliberate a little bit longer this year, so I think they had a hard time too. It was a pretty remarkable group of girls, both academically. They've all done a lot of community service. So yeah, I think the judges had had a hard job ahead of them. So we have at least one girl on this court with 1,000 service hours just in her high school year. So it's pretty impressive what these girls' resumes are when they come to us.
Connecting with those around us is one of the most wonderful parts of living. You can share fears, achievements, vulnerabilities, or dreams. I encourage you all to open your minds, listen more, understand more, and connect more of our stories together.
Spokane is so
so amazing. They make such a difference. They connect us. We're so connected here. We honor our military so well. We have so many programs for our youth. To create such amazing women like those that I get to stand by for the next year. We have so many beautiful things that make Spokane unique and united.
We are Spokane.
In 1938, under the guidance of the Associated Garden Clubs and the Spokane Floral Association, a one-day event was planned and grew into a week-long festival in the following years. Over time, what began as a seed has blossomed into a spectacular, cherished festival, honoring our military, youth, families, and our beautiful region.
There are so many great things happening in Spokane. This is a very dynamic community. It has super economic potential, and I want the state to be a good partner with Spokane.
Why this thing has grown into such a tremendous event is to honor and thank the military, the men and women who serve in the armed forces, and you know, Spokane just does it right. I mean, they light it up, and it's a beautiful event.
The Lilac Festival is Spokane. It is us showcasing our community, really honoring our youth and really honoring our military. The quality of life that we have here in Spokane is next to none, and the Lilac Festival is a part of that quality of life.
So you saw our mission statement, it was included in the video really, empowering our youth, showcasing our region, and honoring our military. I'm going to talk for a couple minutes about the second two, showcasing our region and empowering our youth, and then I'll talk a little bit about military. Showcasing our region, I think the parade is obviously a big way in which we do that. We get to highlight the bands, the great things around our community, our great downtown. But we also go out to other communities throughout the summer and the fall and showcase Spokane to them. We take our float, we take our princesses, I go, and we share about Spokane. And so we're highlighting Spokane, Spokane region, out to all those other communities. And that's a lot of fun for us, but it's also, I think, important to remind those places that Spokane is here and we exist. One of the other things we did new since COVID, actually, was also start a Brewfest. And we did our first one last year. If you didn't know, it was downtown. We closed one of the streets on festival day. And we had about 600 people there that day. It was just our first time. 16 local breweries. It turned out really great. So great that this year we're getting bigger. It's going to be in the park this year on festival day. We'll have 34 breweries, not just from Spokane, but from the larger inland northwest and even some from the Seattle area too. So come out and buy some tickets and have some great beer. Let me talk about empowering our youth. Again, back to the parade. Last year we had 43 marching bands in the parade, so it's a great way to showcase our youth and our great musically talented high schools. But the princesses and the princess and the royalty program is another great way in which we do that. It's really not a beauty pageant. Some people think it is. It's really not. It's a professional training program and a scholarship program. So we invite senior girls to participate from the high schools in Spokane County. Any high school senior can apply to participate. That all goes through the high schools first. Each high school in Spokane County can then submit an applicant to us. Pretty basic requirements, 3.0 GPA and a couple other things. But from that point forward, we get one from each high school. The more the merrier. We love a big group. And we do 2 months of really training program. We do interview training, we do resume writing training, we do stage presence and speaking. We do a number of other things really to help enable them and empower them and help develop them as professionals and future leaders of our community. From then, and Charlie was one of our judges this year, he can talk more about it, but from there, then we narrow the group down to 7. And that's how we get to our princesses. And then later choose a queen based on another round of judging and presentation. So and they all get scholarship money. All the seven of them get scholarship money. It's a great program. Honoring our military, which we'll get to more here in a second, but that's really one of our core principles and what we've been doing since the very beginning. The parade, again, is a military parade. That's always been a big part of it. It's now a torchlight parade. It hasn't always been, but it is now. And it's really a military parade. We want veterans out there. We want active military to be in the parade. And it's I go to a lot of parades now, being a part of the Lilac Festival. And our Spokane parade, if you haven't been to other parades in other places, is one of the best parades in the Northwest. Love it. We have a lot of fun. But the main thing is that we're honoring our military as part of it. And if you haven't been to the parade recently, come out and watch. Just watch the crowd as military units come by. The Spokane community really supports our military, and it's a great way to do it. But there's a couple other things that we really do to help support the base as well. One of the things we do in the summer is do a golf tournament. This year it'll be in August. And that all the funds that come from that go to the base morale fund, and that goes to support things that the federal government really can't spend money on. And it gives the base some opportunity to do to that. Things like maybe a family member died and they don't have money to fly home to attend a funeral. That might provide money for things like that. So it helps support the airmen on the base. The other thing is festival week. So the parade is May 20th, that's a Saturday. The night before that, May 19th, this year, it's May 19th, we have our gala. And one of the things that we do as part of that event is honor the Airmen of the Year. And so it's an opportunity for them to get out, have some fun, and for the community really to highlight them and celebrate why they're Airmen of the Year. So those are all the things that Lilac Festival does, among other things, but those are really the primary things. Let me go on here. My 2023 theme is Onward. A lot of, you know, COVID was a challenging time for a lot of people in a lot of different ways, unique to everybody. But one of the things I wanted to highlight for this year was that we're back to normal, we're moving forward, we're doing great things, and let's celebrate that. And there's a train on there just because I love trains. And trains have never been a central theme to a Lilac Festival theme before, so that was fun too. If you want to connect with us, here's all the great ways. Send me an email. We love having volunteers, whether it's year-round or even just for an event. Come out and help us out, support us, and just be part of the fun. And I think Colonel's next after this one. Right, Jenna? Where's Jenna? I don't know. Anyway, I think, go ahead, come on up.
I think I wasn't supposed to click until it...
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thanks. All righty. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Colonel Chesley Dykus. I am the wing commander of the 92nd Air Refueling Wing, which Amy so graciously introduced. I'm also the installation for Team Fairchild. So for Fairchild Air Force Base, when I say Team Fairchild, that includes the 92nd Air Refueling Wing, the 141st Air Refueling Wing of the Air National Guard, and the 336th Training Group called SERE, more commonly Survival, Evasion, Resistance, and Escape. That belongs to Air Education and Training Command. So Amy gave me a very lovely and flattering intro. Let me give you the brass tacks here. I'm a product of the Tennessee public school system. I have a very simple mind, and when I was in high school, I learned show something by video, if at all possible. So we're gonna start with a video. It lasts about 2 minutes. I am going to leave. I never speak without leaving time for questions at the end. So we're going to work our way through this and leave hopefully plenty of room for questions.
From its construction in 1942, Fairchild Air Force Base was built for one purpose: to project combat air power into the Pacific Theater. Now, 8 decades later, we've been called to carry the torch into a new era. We're faced with new adversaries, more complex challenges, and constant pressure to innovate. But even as the mission evolves, so do the airmen that have made this team great. This year, we have pushed the limit of what was previously thought possible with the 72-hour endurance mission. Team Fairchild no longer trains the individual with one task in mind, but demands an airman that is multi-capable and able to support the mission in a diverse set of roles. The exercises we participated in this year are more relevant than ever because they're tailored to meet the ongoing challenges we face as a force. In 2022, we have redefined lethality as a mobility force. And yet, as the sun sets on the accomplishments of last year, we must look forward to the challenges of 2023. Repetition without innovation leads to complacency. We do not train for the sake of training. We train because last year's exercise could be this year's fight.
All right, so I want to attempt to tie some things together. This is going to be a very simple presentation, but I want to talk to you about what's going on at Fairchild Air Force Base and my own personal priorities. And how that relates to organizations like the Lilac Festival Association, and how that contributes. Because it's the if you piece together Sam and I's presentations, the Lilac Festival Association started in 1938. Fairchild Air Force Base came to be in its beginnings in 1942 through a deal with the city of Spokane. So that tells you a good deal about the depth and the breadth of that relationship. So real quick, if you didn't pick it up from the video, Amy did a phenomenal job of reading my bio, and I'll give you another spoiler alert. Our bios are just a collection of half-truths to get us invited to speak at the Rotary Club. And so there's a lot going on in the world. It's a tumultuous place, so I'm going to talk in terms of my own personal priorities, which are airmen, mission, and culture, and how this relates to the Lilac Festival. So Amy talked about what we do at Team Fairchild in the 92nd Air Refueling Wing. I think in simple terms, as previously discussed, we get paid to be ready, to go where our nation's leaders decide we need to go to provide air refueling to defend our nation's interests. That's what we get paid to do. How do we do that? This gets to the priorities. So I'll come back to airmen, mission, and culture. We have approximately 3,500 airmen in the 92nd Air Refueling Wing. When you add on the 141st, the 336, and families, we get up to approximately 10,000 people on the base, counting families. Again, it's not a science project, and I don't say that number to brag. It's just to give you an idea of the scope. But so to bring this back, I'm a firm believer that as the commander, if I do the best job I can to take care of their airmen and families, and we set a healthy culture, which is quite frankly where I spend most of my time, that those airmen, regardless of what the right number is, they will do their very best to take care of that mission. And that mission right now, aside from being ready, I'm sure all of you read the news, we are rather focused on a term called near-peer competition. And what that really means, the video talked about projecting air power into the Pacific theater. For us, that means it's very cut and dry from the leadership of Air Mobility Command right now. Our job is to deter and defeat China if and when required. And so that is a significant change from how we have done things for the last 20 years. We have gotten rather accustomed to going to places that, while they're not as nice as Fairchild Air Force Base, they look a lot like Fairchild Air Force Base. They're quite secure, minus the desert surroundings. That's the biggest difference. But we are having what equates to a paradigm shift of how we deploy and fight if and when necessary. So where this comes, where I like to tie in the Lilac Festival, is taking care of our airmen and families. It's also important to me that we have a strong bond, because the stronger our bond, the more we have a stronger community. Number one, how we open the meeting, a group of people that need each other. But it also helps our airmen, who most 90%+ of them are not in their hometown. It helps them feel more comfortable, which helps them, which makes them better airmen and more capable of being ready when and where we need them to. So hats off to the Lilac Festival, because it is just one of many, many great examples of the strength of that bond between Fairchild Air Force Base, Team Fairchild, and the greater Spokane community. With that, what questions or thoughts can I entertain? Thank you.
Talk about some of the awards from last year's three inspections in 1 year.
So my predecessor, Cassius Bentley, he did a great job of reminding me of this on my way in. So to put it bluntly, I told you I'd be candid. An inspection is just a real thorn in the side for a wing commander. And Cassius and team had more than they should have, to be candid with you. But to Mark's point, they all went quite well, which is one indicator. It's not the only indicator, but it's one indicator of a healthy organization. I will tell you, so that those are inspections. Another award that I'm quite proud of, it's not Fairchild Air Force Base, it's the greater Spokane community, is the Abilene Trophy. So for those of you that are not aware, the city, the greater Spokane area, the city of Spokane, won the Abilene Trophy, which is another indicator of the strength of the bond between the base and the community. And furthermore, is another indicator of a healthy base, if you will. That answer your question, Mark?
Hey, we've got a question back here.
Thank you for your service. For years, we lobbied to get the newest refueler, the 46A, and in the end, we actually did better by getting a lot more PC-135s here, and made the base even stronger. My question is, what's the future look like for that plane, and therefore for the future of the base? Does it have many more years of life?
Absolutely. So, yes, things didn't roll our way with getting the 46, but the need for air refueling is not going to go away. I can tell you that the base is quite safe. I don't know. At some point, we will no longer have KC-135s. But I will tell you, with 71 of them, there is so much. There is not a lack of safety in the fact that the KC-46 didn't come here. There is an immense amount of safety in the fact that we have 71 KC-135s. The need for air refueling is not going away. We're the DOD, we're the Air Force and DOD's only super tanker wing. So I can tell you with a great deal of confidence that Fairchild Air Force Base is very safe.
I'll ask a question. You alluded to the South China Sea tension. What does it look like to the Spokane people that are stationed with you when it comes to those patrols that go up and down in the South China Sea? Do folks fly out from here and go refuel those fighters that are going up and down in there? Or what transpires?
Sir, to be quite honest with you, I don't have that level of fidelity on individual taskings. So what I can tell you is there's a KC-135 squadron in Japan, and my guess is that they do a good bit. They do most of that support. However, right now we have aircraft and crew at that particular base in Japan supporting their operations. So yes, it happens. I can't exactly tell you exactly the number of taskings or the number of repetitions.
Colonel, could you tell the club what a typical mission would be like for a crew of one of your planes? You said you fly west to the Pacific. How long are you in the air on a typical mission? And Are there, we just heard from a sleep study expert yesterday or last week, and he works for DOD and talks about fatigue in pilots. Uh-huh. So just wonder whether that's an issue among missions.
Absolutely, sir. So the short answer to your question is it depends on where you're going and what you're doing. Sometimes KC-135s take off and they go somewhere and their goal is just to get there. They can stay aloft for 12 to 13 hours. They can stay in flight for a long, long time if they are not giving their fuel away to other receivers. That's one example. In some cases, there are a multitude of fighter aircraft, so little airplanes, behind the tanker. That slows up the tanker. Those missions take longer. They're a lot more tedious. It's quite easy to sit at cruise. It's not so easy when you constantly have airplanes coming up behind you that need gas. So the short answer is that it depends. And I have flown several different airplanes, and I've done my fair share of what we call 24-hour duty days. And yes, they do. They take quite a toll on the body. I was 10 to 15 years younger when I did most of them, and I could tell a difference when I took a break from flying and was on more of a 9-to-5 schedule. It absolutely does take a toll on the human body and the human mind.
Just if you can answer this, but the balloon, the Chinese balloons that are coming over.
It's not good news, but it does not affect our mission at Fairchild.
Colonel, thank you for your service. Two questions. One is recruiting. How is recruiting for new airmen for your crew, and how's that look? And also, what is the percentage of men versus women crew that you have on base?
Recruiting, we don't, the way the Air Force, I don't want to speak for the other services, but the way that the Air Force does recruiting, it's what I call a corporate entity. It's led by Headquarters Air Force at the Pentagon. So we all, everyone that wears this is involved in recruiting. I'm recruiting right now. To be quite frank, in one aspect of the definition of recruiting. However, that aside, there's an aspect of recruiting just by sending our airmen out in the community, bringing entities on base, whether that's an ROTC club or a group of high schoolers or a Rotary club. So there's a certain aspect of recruiting that we are capable of, but largely the X's and O's of actual recruiting are done by recruiters that have been trained and usually report to someone in a different zip code. So it's complicated. As far as right now, we don't necessarily see, there's a lot of news out there about recruiting and last year's numbers. That's more of a future problem than a now problem, but for the recruiters, for the operational units, that's a future problem. For the recruiters, that's a now problem that they have to address at the moment. And sir, to your point about, I don't know exactly the number of females, but I would venture a decent guess of probably somewhere in the neighborhood of about 10%.
How old are you? And how old were you when you started, and what was your journey like to get to this point?
Well, sir, that's a great opportunity. I'll throw it out for guesses. Who wants to take a stab? Charlie is stricken. Charlie has insider information.
21.
What was that, ma'am?
21.
Please find her a cookie. I just celebrated my 46th birthday on March 25th. So I was, how old was I when I started? When I graduated from high school, I hate talking about me, but I'm going to talk about me to tell a little bit of a story. I have a profound love for the Air Force. I also have a certain dislike at times for the way that we do things, to be candid. But I say jokingly, the Air Force has funded my life adventure. And I am incredibly thankful. I've had the opportunity. I've flown 4 or 5 different airplanes. I've been to every single continent except Antarctica, and you can keep Antarctica, especially after this winter here in Fairchild. I'll be A-okay with not doing that. But when I graduated from high school, I had no clue what I wanted to do. And I say jokingly, because I didn't pay attention in high school, that I had to go to 13th grade. Well, I started that journey in 18. At 18, I went to a prep school in Virginia. I got my ACT/SAT score to where I could eventually get accepted to the Air Force Academy. And I just, when I showed up, I just wanted to graduate from the Air Force Academy. I wasn't exactly an aviation enthusiast, and when it came time to pick what I wanted to do, I said flying airplanes sounds like a pretty cool way to make a living. And here I stand however many years later. I graduated from the Air Force Academy in 2000 at the ripe age of 23. And I am working on my 23rd year of time in the Air Force, not counting my time at the Air Force Academy, which was quite frankly some of the more stressful, but that's beside the point.
So 46.
46, sir.
Thank you.
President Higgins had mentioned the Honorary Commander Program. Can
mm-hmm.
you tell the group a little bit more about that?
So this is another, I wouldn't necessarily say recruiting, but it's a means. So let's come back to post 9/11. After 9/11, we, as a nation, we came to understand that we were under attack. And so we tightened security at airports, military bases, places where people gather. And so there was this effort to make a lot of different places more secure. Well, what we did, unbeknownst to us and not quite a priority at the time, is we shut off outside guests from our installations, be it Air Force, Navy. When I was a cadet at the Air Force Academy, you just got waved through. There was no check your ID. A guy sat there like this, and he literally, if he saw a sticker on your car, he just waved you through. Now, if there wasn't a sticker, you would have to have your ID checked. But and in doing so, we lost some ability to tell our story. And the results of that the highest ranking person in the Air Force has concluded, is because we are not very good at telling our story, in his case and purpose to Congress, sometimes we don't fare as well during the budget season. So the honorary commander, this is a long way to say, the honorary commander program is just another way to establish relationships and crosstalk between our commanders, whether they be 06s, 05s, or 04s, and local community leaders. Again, with the same purpose, much like the Lilac Festival, of strengthening bonds between Team Fairchild as a whole and the greater Spokane community. Does that answer your question, sir?
Thank you for being here. I have a son currently serving. You mentioned the job and the focus is to be ready.
Mm-hmm.
Are we?
We are. The problem, ma'am, to be, we are, in my opinion. Regretfully, you don't know how ready until it's time to prove it. And so that is, we're incredibly ready for what we've done the last 20 years. And we're having to shift the focus of being ready to, quite frankly, a scenario that looks more like the Pacific Theater of World War II. And we are getting there. But I will be candid in telling you, the truth is you never really know until you have to prove it. We've proven that we're ready to execute counterterrorism operations. We are working on preparing and making sure that we're ready to deploy to somewhere in the Indo-Pacific theater if and when called. But I am confident in our ability to get out the door, adapt, and overcome.
Thank you, Colonel, for your service and for being here. And I'm kind of curious to switch back to your focus on culture.
Mm-hmm.
And changing or sustaining culture is a challenge for any leader. So mm-hmm. I'm curious, what have you found? Are you sustaining or changing the culture? And what are you doing to enhance whatever it is your vision is on with regards to that?
So when I look at culture, I ask myself one question. What is it that I value? And then the next question, is it fair to assume that the Air Force values that? So if I could attempt to describe, culture is hard to describe. You know, you don't know a good or a great culture until you see it. And much like any organization, the organization takes upon the personality of its leader. And so that is why I ask myself, what do I value? If I could explain, so what do I value? I played a lot of sports in my life. I value teamwork because teamwork makes our mission better and more effective. It also is a source of resiliency for our airmen. Part of teamwork, it goes hand in hand with teamwork, inclusion. So it's inclusion to me is a precursor to teamwork. Appreciation for those that raise their hand and decide that this is what they want to do, that take an oath. We absolutely owe it to our airmen to show appreciation for that. We also owe it to them to show empathy. If they trust us enough to come to any of us, any leader should be a damn good problem solver. And when someone comes to you with a problem, I think it's important to listen with empathy. Don't listen to respond. Don't listen to argue. Listen with empathy to understand. That is, and in doing so, if we, and it's, culture is a lot more complicated than that. But if we can do those things, I think we enhance our ability to execute our mission, which makes us ready, ma'am. And we also have a source of resilience amongst the airmen. And the more that they enjoy living in the greater Spokane community, that's also another source of not just resilience, but also motivation. Did that answer your question, ma'am? Culture's tough.
We have a Zoom question. If you could comment on the growing West Plains civilian community and whether you're feeling at all crowded out.
The short answer is no. So one of my good friends here, Mark Losh, we have teamed on several things. So because the base is the base and there's a fence line and that's just how it is, and we're not gonna change that anytime soon, there's little risk of being crowded out, but it's quite clear that new businesses are popping up along the highway in Airway Heights. I know Cheney is also growing. Quite frankly, in some respects, it's a great thing because there's more restaurants, there's more things to do. But Mark and I have talked about, I did not know this until probably about a month ago, that Spokane County is the fastest growing county in all of Washington State. And the Airway Heights, the region the base is in, is one of the fastest growing parts of that. And with that comes goodness, but also with that comes some things that you maybe don't want, like increased crime. This is another reason it's important for me to get out and talk about going on base, because I cross paths with people that can help. And hopefully we can be, I'll give you a great example of how we try to help with this problem. So our defenders, so those are our Air Force cops that wear this, and they don't look just like Spokane police, but they behave just like them. Their job is law enforcement. The Spokane County Sheriff's Department has an office in the same building that our Air Force police reside in. And that helps, so that just gives them another place of proximity to help anytime that the Spokane County Sheriff's Office needs their help. That is a relationship I am incredibly proud of, because not only does it help keep our airmen at Fairchild Air Force Base safe, it also puts skin in the game for us to help keep the greater Spokane County hopefully a safer place.